kake muna ba masu hakuri saboda kasan shishin mu na bune faru da saboda canjin wutar lantarki da muka yi daga generator mu zuwa NEPA amma kuma yadda dai zamu cigaba da fanku shishin mu daga wannan tasha mai aman sautu wato FCFM akan mita 93.7 kuma yanzu gwamnati cewa karfe 3:30 a shirin mu na gaba shiri ne na economics 224 saboda ka ayi saurari lafiya
abadana wanda ke wakar ga kamar gida da gini to ba ne dibin bari rana wake gida da diyan da ke da shiri FCFM kun ga haske mai kyalli.
So good afternoon listeners, our next program is economics 225. So okay, happy listening.
Students, you are welcome to this class. CRS 225, History of Christianity in West Africa. It's a 1 hour credit course. For today, we are going to be discussing on the topic Before the Dawn of Evangelical Revival in Europe. Before the Dawn of Evangelical Revival in Europe. But before then, we have already considered the Portuguese enterprise, the Portuguese Christian enterprise in West Africa. By the way, the Portuguese missionary enterprise in West Africa were basically Catholic missionaries. The Catholic missionaries, as we have already discussed. I want somebody there to tell me one of the main reasons why the Portuguese missionaries came to Nigeria. Yes, that is right. They came in search of mineral resources, okay? Trade routes and make friend, a kind of friends with the Africans for commerce and to plant Christianity in West Africa. Good. That's okay. But today, our objective, we expect that at the end of this lesson we are going to look at now, Before the Dawn of Evangelical Revival in Europe, we should be able to describe the situation in Europe that prepared the way for the revival in Europe. The lifestyle of people in Europe that prepare the way for revival in Europe. Should be also be able to describe or mention some of the people that contributed a paved way for the revival in Europe. So now let's go down to the issues. By way of introduction, when you are talking of revival, I'm sure you know what you mean by revival. You talk of revival when something is dying, you want to bring it up. Want to cause life into things that is dying. Want to awaken. That is why at times awakening or revival is used. You will find it in literature. You may see here the great awakening, the revival, and or revival. So today, the revival in Europe, the foundation, the revival in Europe constitutes a foundation for the missionary movement in Europe. And it was that missionary movement, which was basically Protestant initially. You know, we have already discussed that the Portuguese missionary enterprise were basically Catholic. But the 18th century missionary enterprise began with the Protestant missionary movement. We came up. Which was the upsurge of evangelical revival in Europe. Now we are looking at what happened that gave way, that people began to agitate for a revival. So the revival in Europe was at the backdrop of a pervasive godlessness. Pervasive godlessness. What I mean by pervasive godlessness, almost everywhere, everybody there was this attitude or belief in godlessness, no belief in God, acting and living as no God. No God at all to be responsible unto. That kind of attitude characterized the lifestyle of majority of people in Europe in the 18th century, by the beginning of 18th century. What gave way to this was the rise of secular philosophy. Particularly, philosophy of deism, which have no regard whether God is there or not, I don't care. So the deism philosophy, the philosophy of deism, I put it again, paved way for this attitude of godlessness in the whole of Europe. Now, the deism came in because of the what we call the Renaissance Age that was prepared by an age of intellectualism. Renaissance Age generally describes age of knowledge, age of intellectualism. People begin to have quests for knowledge, quest for more information, development of science. At the end, the product of this Renaissance age in Europe was the secular philosophy, which has no space at all. We had no space for biblical revelations of the Christians. The secular philosophy that pervaded the whole of Europe, as I say it again, had no space, had no recognition of the biblical revelation of the Christian. What we mean by that? The Christian faith generally is based on revelation. It's a revealed religion based on revealed book. I say it again. The Christian faith is a revealed religion based on a revealed book. We want to talk of God. Where is God? People believe in God because it's a revelation. But the philosophy of the age at that time had no regard for anything that you are going to talk of as a revelation. But rather, they want to believe in science, they want to believe in a practical thing, something that is palpable. If it is not that, forget about it. So the end of this was that the Christian at that time gave up some of the basic tenets of their Christian belief. I say it again. The basic tenets of Christianity were now ignored. Issue of prayer, that is the importance of prayer, the place for prayer was ignored. Who want to pray? Why pray? When you don't believe in God, why pray? This was the idea that was now reigning at that time. Issue of faith. Christian believe by faith. The just shall live by faith. Christianity is a religion based on faith. But the issue of faith at this time where it was issue of faith was relegated. So the idea of miracles was nonsensical. People don't believe in miracles. If people don't have faith, you can't get miracles. If you don't if you want miracle, there must be faith. And if you don't believe in miracle, there's no need for faith. Also, the idea of belief in heaven or hell. These are the tenets I'm mentioning now. We also ignored. We are relegated. The need for good standards, for good moral standards, were also thrown into the mud. The need for good moral standards of living were counted like as rubbish, thrown into the mud. Take it again to replay on the, revise on the tenets of Christian faith that were neglected to give you a picture of the type of Christianity that was practiced at that time, that now gave room or paved way for revival. As I said, people began to neglect, ignore the importance of prayer. They see no reason for prayer. They see no need for prayer in their personal life, in their family life, in the church. Why go to church to pray? And you know, prayer is one of the basic tenets of Christian faith. No need for faith. Faith, as I said, is another basic tenet of the Christian faith. Miracle, believe in miracle, is another basic tenet of Christian faith. Even the birth of Christ was miraculous. So you cannot throw away belief in miracle and the Christian can still stand. Believe in the existence of heaven and hell was also neglected. The belief in the existence of heaven and hell as a basic tenet, as I said, was also neglected. The need for moral standards. Moral standard for individuals in the society was also neglected as a basic tenet. Well, it may surprise you to note that in this tenet or in the neglect of this tenet, the priest, what I mean is this, the priest, or put it better put, the clergy at that time were not immune, the clergy was not immune to the effect and influence of deism and secular philosophy in the society. You can imagine then where the pastor, where the priest, where the leaders in the church do not believe in prayer, do no longer believe in faith, do no longer believe in miracles, do no longer believe in the inspiration of the Bible, do no longer hold the Bible as an inspired word of God. You can imagine the type of Christianity they will practice. So the philosophy of the day completely eroded moral standard. It was such that the Decalogue, what you call the Decalogue, you know the Decalogue, that the Ten Commandments, you have thou shalt not and thou shalt. Somebody put it this way, that the life in Europe at that time was as if the not were removed from thou shalt not and put in where you have thou shalt. For instance, what I mean is this. Thou shalt honor thy father and mother. Thou shalt have no other God before me. Thou shalt remember to keep the Sabbath day holy. Now, if you use the carry knot now, thou shalt, and now you now put the knot, thou shalt not honor thy father and mother. You can imagine what that looks like. Thou shalt not remember to keep the Sabbath day holy. They have imported knot now into that place to put knot. And where you have thou shalt not, the knots are removed. If you now say, thou shalt not commit adultery. If you remove the knot, what does it become? Somebody say that. Somebody tell me, if you remove, thou shalt not commit adultery, you remove knot from it, what does it read like? Yes, thou shalt commit adultery. If you remove the knot, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's property. You remove the knot. What does it look like? Somebody else? Thou shalt covet thy neighbor's property. Good. Thou shalt not kill. Yes, somebody, if you remove the knot, what does it sound? How does it look like? Thou shalt kill. So, this was the life pattern. This was the lifestyle. This is what characterized the life of people in Europe at that time. So, at the end of it all, the world became churchy, and the church became worldly. What do we mean by that? You could no longer differentiate the church from the world. What happens in the church and what happens outside the church? See the standard, see the commandment, see the rule. The rules that govern, that moderated the church have been removed, have been thrown into the mud. It was no longer possible to have good moral standard. So you can imagine now a society where there's no prayer, there's no reading the Bible, because at that time they don't believe the Bible in the inspired word of God. It's just a book. It's just a book like any other book. There was no difference between the Bible and any other book. There's no prayer. There's no. Why go to church to pray? So this was the situation in Europe at that time that called for a revival. But let's be quick to say that although majority of the people in Europe embrace the secular philosophy of deism, there were still remnants. There were still very few people who did not embrace that secular philosophy of the day. So these few people, some of them, although people is not going to churches, going to prayer, going to prayer meeting, believe in miracles, believe in the Bible, there were still few people who were meeting together to pray. Example of such people were the people that were meeting in a particular street called Clan Farm. And this group of people were later nicknamed clan farm set. This group of people, the clan farm set, they were meeting in a particular street in Europe called Clan Farm. People like Philip Spencer of 1663 AD to 1705 AD. August Frank also was there. Also within the 1663 to 1727 AD. These people gathered together. These people were always gathering together for prayers. These people met together, prayed, read the Bible, studied the Bible. Even though a good majority of the people have no regard for the Bible anymore, but they were still very few. Just like in any church. You may find in some churches the people may not believe this, may not believe that, but there are still very few who hold to the word of God. Still very few who meet together for prayer to study the word of God. They still believe God. They still hold to their Christian faith. So they are meeting together regularly to pray. Not just to pray. They met also together to discuss some issues that affect the society. One of the major issues that affected the society at that time was the slave trade. A good lot of Africans were bought as slaves and transported to Europe. And they were working with their slave master. Oh, the owners of the slave who bought them over there in their farms. And they were subjected to all kinds of dehumanized conditions and situations. These situation or condition of slaves became one of the concerns of these Christians who met together, who did not embrace the secular philosophy of deism. So, they started sensitizing the society of the idea, and we are going to, maybe in the next week, you read about that, we are going to be discussing on the revival itself in Europe. Read that ahead, revival in Europe. So they were sensitizing the people on the need for abolition of slavery. We'll talk more on that in our next lesson. But for now, we're going to have, want somebody to quickly tell me, answer this question. Mention some of the characteristics, lifestyle of people in the early 18th century in Europe. Yes, that's correct. Belief in a secular philosophy of deism. Yes, prayerlessness, people not being giving place to prayer again. That's okay. That's all right. Yes. People don't believe in the inspiration of the Bible. That is true. That is correct. So next time, we are going to take more. Before we go, take another question. What was the major and general secular philosophy of the people in Europe by the 18th century that affected the people? What do I call it? Philosophy of deism. Good. That is good. That is good. So next week, next lesson, we'll be looking at the evangelical revival in Europe itself. So the lesson will come to an end here. I'm Pastor Dr. Apeabu from CRSD.